And welcome to our Christian Literary Imagination series. Today is the 11th event in this series, which is promoted by Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative in association with Las Casas Institute, Blackfriars Hall, and Campion Hall, the University of Oxford. Today, Father Joseph Simmons, SJ, will be welcoming Dr. Frank Ambrosio, who will be talking about Dante. We don't do things lightly with this series. We had Milton, then Shakespeare, and now Dante, the three big ones. Well, after the talk, Joe and Frank will take questions submitted from members of our audience, which is internationally based. We have about 100 people here registered today. We encourage you to participate by typing your questions directly to us from the moment we've begun the session. You can do so by using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screens. If you have a question, or if you have questions, please ask it or them, and we will endeavour to answer them either today or later by email. I'll see you later. Enjoy the lecture. Over to you, Father Simmons.
Thank you very much, Mike, and thank you all of you who are joining us across the Atlantic, wherever you might be. We're fortunate today to have Professor Frank Ambrosio, who's an associate professor of philosophy at Georgetown, where he's been working for over 40 years now. After he studied Italian languages and literature in Florence, Italy, he completed his doctoral degree at Fordham University with a specialization in contemporary European philosophy. He's the founding director with Edward Maloney of the Georgetown University My Dante Project, a web-based platform for personal and collaborative study of Dante's Commedia. In 2014, Frank acted as a lead instructor for the launch of an ongoing web course, commonly called a MOOC, on Dante offered by edX, which you can access at dante.georgetown.edu, or just Google Dante and Georgetown as I did. And that has currently been utilized by over 20,000 readers and students worldwide. His most recent book is called Dante and Derrida Face to Face. And today we welcome we welcome Professor Frank Ambrosio as he presents his paper, Dante's Gospel. As Mike said, please send your questions and comments along the way, and we will endeavor to get through as many of them as we can after Frank's presentation. So Frank, over to you.
Thank you, Joe, for that very kind introduction. And it's my pleasure to join Michael and yourself for this event today. The talk, as you know, is entitled Dante's Gospel. In an apostolic letter issued by Pope Francis on March 25th of this year, commemorating the seventh centenary of the Italian poet Dante Alighieri's death, Francis declares that Dante's life and works remain a lasting treasure that embodies the virtue of hope, so desperately needed in today's world. The Pope adds that he appreciates the Catholic poet's work for the, quote, enduring warnings and insights it contains for humanity as a whole, not simply believers, end of quote. In the concluding section of his pastoral letter, Pope Francis declares both the nature of this hope and its universality. Quoting again, Dante today does not wish merely to be read, commented on, studied, and analyzed. Rather, he asks to be heard and even imitated. He invites us to become his companions on his journey. If Dante tells his tale admirably, using the language of the people, yet elevating it to a universal language, it is because he has an important message to convey, one meant to touch our hearts and minds, to transform and change us even now in this present life. It is fitting then, the Pope continues, that the present anniversary serve as an incentive to make Dante's work better known and appreciated, accessible and attractive, not only to students and scholars, but to all those who seek answers to their deepest questions and wish to live their lives to the full, purposefully undertaking their own journey of life and faith with gratitude for the gift and responsibility of freedom, end of quote. Before saying anything else, I want to say clearly that you have already heard what is most important in these remarks. The Pope's message is simple, direct, and urgent. Read Dante today. The poem has been written for you, and it wants to touch your heart, enlighten your mind, and change your life by confessing what the author has seen with his eyes and felt in his heart. Amazing grace. So sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fear relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My job here today was primarily to deliver the Pope's message, as I have done. To try to say any more would only be to add, somewhat gratuitously, my own voice to his, entirely unnecessary. But I would say, yes, me too. I agree wholeheartedly. Read Dante today. Whoever you are, believer or not, it makes no difference. The message is one of hope for everyone. The authority of the message does not lie in Francis being Pope, but rather in his being a wise, compassionate, and courageous human being. The only thing I might have to add to what Francis has said is read Dante's poem as a gospel, the proclamation of good news, the arrival of a hope that beggars the human imagination. All is forgiven. Well and good, but exactly how does one read today a poem written 700 years ago as if it were a repetition of the revelation of divine mystery that had occurred in the person of the Word made flesh 1100 years before that? That revelation was not a poem. That story is not a romance. And Jesus the Savior was not a woman. How can Dante's poem repeat the gospel revelation truthfully and with saving power today? Pope Francis did not, after all, say, read Dante's gospel today. He just said, read Dante's poem today, as if your life depended on it, because it does. And even if you read it, quotes, only as a metaphor, quote, nonetheless, the power of the poem's imagination may help you catch a glimpse of the mystery at the center of human existence that had escaped you until now. The mystery of grace, of love, of forgiveness, the mystery of the gift of responsibility for the freedom, which is the very soul of our humanity. Call it the proclamation of human dignity, if you would rather not call it Dante's gospel. I really do not think Pope Francis would mind either way, as long as you read it today and took it to heart. So now that really is my 2 cents worth, but I signed up to say something about the Christian imagination as well. And I owe it to the brotherhood and sisterhood of Dantisti who teach and write about Dante for a living to try to say a word more about how the Christian imagination works in his poetry. What poetry has to do with gospel and revelation, and what romantic love has to do with any of it. So briefly, I will try. I hope it might be of some added encouragement to you to read Dante today and of some small help in beginning to do so. Since the time is short, I'll confine myself to the first line of the poem in order to identify some of the characteristic features of the Christian imagination. However broad or limited one's familiarity with Dante's Commedia might be, its opening line is likely to be familiar. Nel mezzo del cammin di nostra vita. In the middle of the journey of our life, Dante invites everyone to accompany him on this journey of our nostra life. What is universally shared by every human being is the inseparability of life and death. At the center of the circle of life is death. Death measures the final meaning of every point, of every life point on the circumference which circulates around it. He portrays life as a journey of conversion, a metanoia, or change of mind that is radically different because it changes not only what we see, but how we see everything. It requires that we change our perspective to the one that is possible only from the center, the perspective that opens out on the finality of death as the horizon against which all of life appears and takes on a depth of meaning that it could not otherwise have. Dante's Commedia has been called the drama of the soul's choice because the possibility of all three realms of the afterlife, heaven, hell, and purgatory, is contained at the center of human existence along with death. Freedom is the measure of life and death together, the only absolute measure of the meaning of their relationship. Nel mezzo, in the center, we discover life and death together, and with them, the responsibility for the gift of freedom that gives their relationship its unique and absolute dignity. The dark wood in which the pilgrim first wakes up and realizes he is lost in life, together with hell, purgatory, and paradise, these four places are one place, the same place. They all occupy the space of freedom. At the center of every life, the space that is traditionally called the soul. Imagination is the name we give to this space of freedom. If we're responsible for the gift of freedom and the dignity of our personal identity, it is because that freedom must be used finally to answer the question, who am I? That answer can only be given incarnationally, that is, as a created word of meaning, acted out in a lifetime of choices, actions, and commitments and failings. To live responsibly is to try to imagine the meaning of our lives from the perspective of death. But if imagination names the place of freedom incarnationally, then it does so poetically. Dante, although deeply erudite, is not a philosopher and he's not a theologian. Rather, his vocation as an evangelist is inseparable from his vocation as a poet. He is called to discipleship along the ways of the imagination. The word poetry itself has its descent from the Greek term poiesis, literally making, but not in the sense of fabrication out of materials, but rather making from out of oneself, as in meaning making. This is imagination in the sense proper to the Christian imagination because of its essential connection to divine poetry, the creativity through which all reality came into being through the divine word. The human imagination, exemplified in art, literature, and especially in poetry, imitates divine creativity by giving meaning to the world which was divinely created. In poetry, human imagination plays an essential role in the way that the event of revelation occurs. St. John's Gospel expresses the primal event of revelation by portraying Jesus as the word through which all is created and which itself appears in that world as flesh. Mystery reveals itself as a person who is truly human and truly divine. This paradox of incarnation reveals the name of the inner law through which the secret of divine mystery reveals itself in the world of human experience and history, and that is the law of freedom. As a poet, Dante knows that what is different about his gospel, that it is written in poetry, paradoxically reveals what is the same in all gospel writing, indeed in all revelation, that it is necessarily poetry. Mystery, revelation, paradox, meaning, and metaphor, they all obey the law of freedom. The logic of that law demands full mutuality and unreserved reciprocity. Whatever is divine pours itself out and empties itself totally into flesh, and in so doing opens up the dynamic circulation of reciprocity and mutuality by which humanity responds in turn by allowing itself to be transformed into divinity. Poetic metaphor always obeys the law of freedom by imitating this pattern of circularity and reciprocity. Metaphor is never either or. It's always both and. Both the same and different. Freedom and responsibility name the dignity of human personhood to enter into relationships of love and grace, gift giving and gift returning, and finally the gift of love and grace that forgives the need of the other itself in an unconditional reciprocity and mutuality without reserve. The name of Jesus reveals the mystery that allows the name of the human person Jesus to be different from that of the God whose name must not be spoken. Dante's gospel in poetry invokes the freedom of the Christian imagination to name the revelation of the mystery of incarnation in his life differently. Not Jesus, but Beatrice. Dante's earliest public work was the Vita Nuova. It was astoundingly innovative in its language, his own Tuscan vernacular, rather than the language of the educated elite, Latin. Its poetic style was equally innovative. The so-called Dolce Stil Nuovo was his invention, an outgrowth of the courtly love tradition of literature in the later Middle Ages and of the troubadour tradition of music and poetry. Most radically new, not seen since St. Augustine, was the confession of his own personal story of sin and the hope of salvation that came into his life through Beatrice, in the form of the vocation he received to become the poet worthy of praising her grace. Unfortunately, the constraints of time do not allow even a brief synopsis of the Vita Nuova here, but perhaps its most distinctive feature is that it was composed by Dante in the 2 years that immediately followed Beatrice's premature death at the age of 26. The book breaks off at that point with a confession and a promise. The confession is that his book had in no way done justice to his desire to praise Beatrice as the source of the hope in his new life. He states the promise this way: "If God grant me just a few more years of life, I hope to write of her what never has been written of any other woman." The echo of this promise haunts him over the next 3 decades of his life, through the personal catastrophe of his exile from Florence, separation from family, his own reenactment of the expulsion of Adam and Eve from paradise. All the while, he is a pilgrim in search of the joy that had been lost, the hope which alone could enable him to fulfill his promise of love. The Commedia is the story of the recovery of that hope and the fulfilling of his promise to write of her what never had been written of woman before. That woman, to write, that woman possesses her own way of reimagining the mystery of incarnation and of changing the name of Jesus into that of Beatrice. That reimagining required the entire journey of the poem. Here we can offer only 2 fleeting glimpses of its poetic meaning-making at work, with the caution to remember that the beauty and the power is in the poetry, not in any conceptual prose offered in commentary on the poem. You have to read the poetry and feel its texture. In the pastoral letter, however, Pope Francis calls special attention to the centrality of his namesake, Saint Francis of Assisi, in Dante's personal spirituality and poetic imagination, as well as to what was most urgent in Saint Francis's call for a radical return to the gospel in Western Catholicism at the beginning of the 13th century. In Canto 11 of Paradise, Dante employs the nuptial imagery of the church as the bride of Christ to introduce those twin princes, I quote Dante now, Francis and Dominic, not a quotation yet, those twin princes, Francis and Dominic, whom almost miraculously God had appointed to escort the bride of Christ, the church, so that she could, quoting now, go in joy to her beloved, sure of herself, and now to him more faithful, end of quote. The Franciscan and Dominican reform shares one single vocation to be executed in two different ways. One, that of Saint Francis, seraphic in its ardor. The other, in his wisdom, was on earth resplendent with cherubic light. The spirit of their reformations was to take the form of a return to the gospel in so radical a sense that Dante here goes so far as to characterize Francis as the first and only suitor for the hand of the widowed bride, whom his imagination embodies as Lady Poverty, since she had been separated from her first bridegroom, Jesus. Now I quote from Canto 11 of the Commedia. For, still a youth, he, St. Francis, fought against his father's wish for the favor of the lady to whom, as to death, no one unlocks the door with gladness. And before his spiritual court at Coram Patre, he joined himself to her, and from then on, each passing day, he loved her more. She, bereft of her first husband, scorned and unknown, 1,100 years and more, remained without a suitor until he came. Nor did it profit her when, being fiercely loyal and undaunted, while Mary stayed below, she leapt up with Christ upon the cross. But lest I make my meaning dark, let it be understood in all that I have said that these two lovers are Francis and Poverty. End of quote. Known from early on as God's troubadour, St. Francis's poetic imagination shapes his vocation as a reformer in the nuptial imagery of espousal to the bride of Christ under the appearance of the poverty of the human condition, to which no one opens the door willingly, except in that incarnational gesture of kenosis, by which Christ, according to St. Paul, did not cling to divinity, but emptied himself into the mortality of flesh. In so doing, St. Francis plays the role of godfather to Dante's poetic imagination, allowing him to follow the road that leads from the romance of the courtly love tradition and the lyricism of the troubadour singers who preceded him to an authentically new and creative style of love poetry, to be followed immediately by Petrarch and through the Renaissance to Shakespeare and beyond. On the authority of the reformer prince, St. Francis's new imagery of a return to the gospel portrayed as his mystical marriage to Lady Poverty, confers on Dante the promise of a new life shaped by the vocation to become the poet of Beatrice, who alone allows the word of God to take on flesh in his life and speak the word of his salvation. Now, in conclusion, we turn to a second glimpse of Dante's radical reimagining of the second archetypal metaphor of the Christian imagination, the mystery of the resurrection. In cantos 30 and 31 of the Purgatory, which constitute the climax of the dramatic action of the poem, Beatrice arrives in the earthly paradise at the end of a long liturgical procession in a chariot drawn by a griffin, which allegorically represents the dual nature of Jesus. Her positioning makes it clear that she occupies the place which would normally be reserved in the celebration of the feast of Corpus Domini for the bishop carrying the monstrance containing the Eucharistic bread. Dante, in other words, imagines her precisely in the place of the sacrament of the real presence of Jesus. When Beatrice addresses Dante, she immediately makes her urgent mission clear. He has betrayed his promise to her, not written the poem that he had promised, and he must accept responsibility. Echoing the resurrected Jesus's thrice repeated question to Saint Peter, "Simon Peter, do you love me?" which in turn echoes Peter's thrice repeated repudiation at the time of Jesus's arrest, "I do not know the man." Beatrice three times enjoins Dante, "Oh, say it, if this is true. To such an accusation, your own confession must be joined." Dante tries three times to speak. Twice he fails, and at the third attempt manages only to say, "The present things with their false delights turned back my steps the moment your countenance was hidden from me." End of quote. "All my hope died with you, and in despair, I could not write of you what I had promised, that you and your love were more present to me in death than all the things that distract me in life from the truth and freedom that is written in the word which your eyes and your face say to me always." And then it is done. Beatrice has enjoined him to take upon himself the weight of responsibility to say what the prophet Nathan required David to say, "Yes, I am the man. I am he who gave up the hope of the resurrection and so could not keep my promise to you, to write of you what had never been said of woman before." Beatrice's acknowledgement of Dante's acceptance of responsibility continues the pattern of Peter's confession, in which Jesus replies to Peter's, "Lord, you know that I love you," with the simple injunction, "Feed my sheep." Now the secret is fully revealed. His vocation as poet, his promise of a scripture worthy of her grace, none of this had anything to do with him or her. Rather, the writing was needed to feed the lost sheep. Those in Dante's time and those in our own time, all of us who are hungry and look up to be fed, but find no shepherd to lead us to food. Beatrice acknowledges his acceptance of the responsibility which his vocation as her poet most immediately and seriously imposed on him by enjoining him, just as Jesus had with Peter, "Come, follow me. Follow me in discipleship as I lead you into the truth of the resurrected life and teach you to experience the joy that is the fulfillment of every hope through the forgiveness of sin. You will see through my eyes the immensity of the white rose, where all who have been forgiven and forgive in return stand face to face with each other and every other, so that all can truly be responsible to all for all. Finally, through Mary, the mother of Jesus, my other face, you will receive the vision of the resurrected word which had become incarnate so as to pass through death into the forgiveness of all that hid the beloved face and cause hope to ruin itself in despair. All this will be written in you so that when you come to yourself again, nel mezzo, you can begin to rewrite the same story that you have just lived, or perhaps that you have imagined that you have lived. So in closing, I say this as my small addition to the Pope's message. When you read Dante today, read it as if he were your Virgil, come to help you reimagine the story of the life for which you are always for which you shall always be responsible to all and for all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Frank. Thank you for an excellent paper. And we'll kind of move into our question and answer. I have some to get the ball rolling and a reminder that people can send them in our chat and Q&A below. I suppose what I'm wondering, first of all, I'm reminded of Monsignor Mark Langham, who is a devotee of Dante. He died in January. He served at the Fisher House Catholic Chaplaincy in Cambridge, a kind of a noted clergyman in England. And he loved Dante, and he served on the Pontifical Council for the Promotion of Christian Unity for a long time. And I'm wondering, given some of the stark images that we have and some of the levels of hell, both of heretics, but also of bad popes, right, who weren't embracing Lady Poverty that you spoke of. I wonder, how do you find Dante can speak sort of beyond that, maybe just the Catholic bubble or even the Christian bubble, as you were suggesting? What is it unique about his way of telling a story that allows us to engage in our own storytelling, whether we are Christian or not, whether we can engage the Christian imagination or not? Do you have any thoughts on that?
I have some, Joe, but that's a wonderful question, and it does go very much, I think, to the heart of Francis's message of the universality of this. He says very clearly, Dante is not just for believers. And I think the reason he says that is contained in something else that he says very clearly. He thinks the poem carries a message of responsibility for the gift of freedom. Okay. So he wants to speak, I think, to the human soul understood as the capacity to take responsibility for ourselves, take responsibility for the way in which we live our lives, and the way in which that living amounts to either a yes or a no. But it's not a yes or a no to a particular religious tradition, so much as it is a yes or a no to the promise of hope, the hope of the resurrection through the forgiveness of sin. Okay. And so I think that comes down then to a willingness or a refusal on the part of a human being to take responsibility for themselves and make themselves responsible, not simply for themselves as individuals, but for all human beings and in all things. I use the phrase in there that's borrowed from, some of you may recognize it from Dostoevsky's Brothers Karamazov, when the Russian monk, Father Zosima, tells the story of his older brother who died very young. He speaks about that brother saying, "You know, little brother, we would all be in paradise right now if we could only realize that all are responsible to all for all, unconditionally."
Oh, thank you for that. We had a question coming in. Could you talk a bit about the various ways Dante may have signaled that his works were meant for a general readership rather than an elite readership? And certainly anyone who's got an annotated copy will see in the footnotes all of the little references to people he was having squabbles with, in his native place. So what this questioner I think is asking is how is he signaling that this is indeed meant for everyone and not just for the elite who might be able to read this or understand it. Any thoughts on that?
Yes. All of the three separate parts of the journey, hell, purgatory, paradise, unfold as conversations with a series of individual people. Some of these people are high-born, some of them are famous, others are childhood friends of his from the neighborhood in Florence where he grew up. Some of them are persons who have been directly involved in his exile and therefore are personal enemies. Others, for example, the popes, some of whom he has great contempt and scorn for. But all of these are told by way of personal narratives, he engages them and tries to find a way to allow them to say who they are. And in telling their story, reveal to us why they are in hell, why they are in heaven, why they are still in purgatory. So there's a universality to that, and it's precisely that universality that it is the telling, the way we choose to tell our own story is what determines our fate cosmically and eternally. Okay. And in a way, it's a testimony to that freedom I was speaking about a moment ago. Dante, perhaps, I'm tempted to say, in my experience, I don't know of any more resounding endorsement for the reality or the power of human freedom and responsibility than to state so clearly that human freedom is capable of changing cosmic history forever, including the cosmic freedom of God. Because if a soul says no to the offer of forgiveness, that no is final.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. A question from Paul Edmondson from the Shakespeare Birthplace Trust, who gave a discussion a few weeks ago on Shakespeare and scripture. Mm-hmm. He says, this is all marvelous and compelling, and I already downloaded the Pope's letter to read at leisure. Now, I wonder if Dante engaged with the Song of Songs, arising from his love of Beatrice, and his knowing that love takes us to the word of God. Do you have any sense whether historically he was engaging with the Song of Songs?
I'm going to hedge just a little bit here and say that I believe he is quoting at one point, and it's in the paradise where the eagle of justice speaks and begins his address to the poet by saying, "Love justice, you who rule the earth." Okay. Now, if I'm right in that memory that is directly from the Song of Songs, that's only to say that it seems to me absolutely clear that the notion of the bridegroom and the bride is already essential to the Christian tradition long before the Gospels, and that its repetition throughout the history, up to the nuptial imagery of Saint Francis that we saw, that notion seems central, that the complementarity between what, not so much between man and woman, but between what we would speak of as masculinity and femininity as two principles of the human psyche, that this complementarity is universal, archetypal, and absolutely necessary, so that its reappearance in almost every major world religious tradition in some form or other, and its continuance in the Judeo-Christian and Islamic tradition is a testimony to it being part of the revelation itself.
Thank you. It kind of puts me in mind thinking of Shakespeare. Michael Scott and I were talking, and it doesn't seem that Shakespeare himself would have had any direct reading of Dante, but by way of Petrarch, when you mentioned, there may have been some influence in some of Shakespeare's work, particularly when you talk about the creative style of love poetry you mentioned in your paper, followed immediately by Petrarch and through the Renaissance to Shakespeare and beyond. Do you see any kind of thread, a through line from Dante to Shakespeare, which was the focus of last year's looking at Christian Shakespeare? Any thoughts on that?
Yeah. It so happens that my colleague and good friend at Georgetown, Mike Collins, and I taught for 3 or 4 years a course entitled Dante and Shakespeare together. And we had long and exciting discussions and arguments about parallels and contrasts. I was suggesting in the talk that there's a sense in which Dante is at the very seminal source of what we traditionally call the Renaissance and beyond that of the modern age, and that Shakespeare stands at a more fully realized moment of that historical process. But I think the connection between the two is genuinely direct. I mentioned Petrarch as an intermediary in there. First, of course, in Shakespeare's sonnets. Now, these are, I think, at least in my own amateur estimate of Shakespeare's works, they stand somewhat equivalent to the love poetry of the Vita Nuova. They're an early stage of a life-sustained imaginative meditation on the relationship between two people in its romantic, indeed in its erotic nature, that we experience the longing for the God most intensely in the romantic experience of either love for another person or in love of some great human endeavor. It could be art, it could be music, it could be politics, it could be, it could take many forms. It doesn't have to be. I don't think Dante is imaging Beatrice solely as another person, but rather some way in which the divine takes on flesh and blood form, either as romance or as some other kind of passionate and intimate involvement. It's that intimacy, I think, which makes the difference. Now, Shakespeare later on, explores the gamut of human experience. He's got his equivalent of the Inferno. But see, there's something to be noticed too, that what Shakespeare treats as tragedy is in no sense, well, in a limited sense, equivalent to what Shakespeare to what Dante treats as the realm of the Inferno. Okay, there is no such thing, I think, as a Christian tragedy. They're two different worldviews, and one does not allow for the reality that is at the center of the other. So there's deep continuity, and yet at the same time, deep contrast.
Thank you. We have a question here regarding translation. Wasn't it Derrida who said every translation was a traduction?
Yes.
Yes. Do you have any recommendation for a good at-home readership? I know I'm reading the Henry Gray Henry Gary Gray translation, and then there's the Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, and then I think for the course that you have online, you referred to the Robert and Jean Hollander edition. Do you have any recommendations on what translation and how do you capture the kind of the rhythm and the meter and the life of the original Italian without losing it in translation? Mm-hmm. Any thoughts on that?
You know, Joe, the it's extraordinary to me. I never cease to be amazed at how many new English translations of the poem have emerged in the past 50 or 60 years in the United States or in Britain. And even more so in the last 10 or 15 years, there is an extraordinary dynamism of interest and renewal of interest in Dante in the English speaking world. And in one sense, the abundance of choice among translations is a tremendous boon, but in another sense, it's a burden because most of us don't have the time or energy to compare five or six different translations. But if one enjoys the luxury of the leisure and energy and interest to do that, comparing translations oneself is one of the most rewarding contemplative exercises a way of getting more deeply into the texture of the poem in translation by seeing the way two or three different translators mediate those differences, how they make the word become flesh again in the translation into a different language. The Hollander translation, which is the one that we use on the My Dante platform, is of course extraordinary, and we were extremely grateful to Professor and Mrs. Hollander for giving us permission to use that very generously. But if that were not available, we would have turned to the Longfellow translation because it is, you know, in the public domain and therefore can be used without royalty. But also because it is extraordinarily evocative and rich and immediate in its language, precisely because it's not contemporary, either American or British English. Mentioning that, the American-British distinction, Dorothy Sayers' translation, which was published by Penguin immediately after the Second World War, is an extraordinary testimony to the genius and the freedom of translation. She undertakes the very challenging task of replicating the alternating rhyme pattern of Dante's Terza Rima. And everyone is quick to point out there's a big difference between English and Italian in many ways, but one of them certainly is Italian is rhyme rich because everything ends in a vowel. English is comparatively rhyme poor because you don't have that limitation to the final sound of the word. Okay, so if you're going to get English to rhyme, you're going to have to be very, very imaginative, very creative, and at times change the diction of the poem so as to fit it into that form. Many people, therefore, don't like Sayers' translation because it's not in any sense, it's much less literal. But in another sense, it's got a music to it and a poetic character in the rhyme that, you know, is truly very, very close to Dante. One other thing about Sayers' translation, she has wonderful, wonderful, not footnotes, but commentary along the way that is very, very enriching to the experience. And I'll mention one other, and that's Charles Singleton, who is really the godfather of the revival of American Dante studies in the 1940s and 50s. Charles Singleton, it's published by Princeton. His goes to the opposite extreme from Sayers in that it makes no attempt to be poetic. It is completely blank verse, not even verse, it's closer to prose, but it stays immensely close to the Italian. And if you want to follow the Italian, even if you have only a bit of Italian or Latin, if you want to follow the Italian text, Singleton can help you do that by giving you an extremely close translation of the Italian. So, and that's a great question, because when one goes to Amazon and looks over the possibilities of translation, it is truly an embarrassment of riches.
Yeah, certainly. Actually, Dorothy Sayers, her birth house is just down the block on Brewer Street from Campion Hall, where I'm studying currently. I'm not there at the moment, but.
Right. No. And she was part of that, the Oxford group of which Tolkien was part, and C.S. Lewis, of course. The richness of the treatment of Catholic imagination among that group is, as you well know, and is central to many of the discussions that has gone on here. Extraordinary.
Mm-hmm. We'll have to go probably in the next 3 or 4 minutes and hand it off, but I have a few more questions. It's interesting reading through the lens of my own theological and philosophical education, and people come to a text with whatever they have, but I was thinking even kind of in the first circle when they're going into meeting all of these sort of noble pre-Christians from Roman history, from classical literature. I wonder, do you think that in any way has informed sort of the conception that maybe Karl Rahner would have had about the anonymous Christian and sort of elevating these non-Christian voices? I used the term Christian bubble earlier. I wasn't meaning to be diminishing either of Christians or those outside of it, but just outside of what we would consider the Christian literary imagination. How do you think those things come into influence?
I'll try to be concise about this, something which is not easy for me. On the same plane with the centrality of Beatrice in the poem is the figure of Virgil and what I think can be referred to as the problem of Virgil, because Virgil is a problem, a huge problem that Dante cannot avoid confronting directly in the poem, because Virgil is often spoken of as representing reason. True enough, in a rather stiff allegorical sense, he represents poetry. He represents the power of poetry, in the Aeneid to embody the fate of the classical world in the person of Aeneas, okay, to incarnate that entire culture in the person of Aeneas and set its pattern of virtue. Beatrice chooses Virgil and goes to Virgil in the circle of limbo and says, "You have to help my friend." He says, without hesitation, "Of course, because you ask it." You know, Virgil is a chivalric knight who will do anything the noble lady asks. And so he leads Dante through hell and up the mountain to purgatory, having announced from the very beginning that that's as far as he can go, and that when he gets him there, he has to go back home. The problem of Virgil is this. If not for Virgil's willingness to guide Dante, standing for poetry and for the poetry of the so-called pagan humanism of the Greco-Roman culture, okay, without Virgil, no salvation for Dante, no reunion with Beatrice. Yet he is excluded from salvation. How can you possibly think I'm going to buy that story? In Canto 20 of the Paradise, we have one of the most peculiar episodes of the entire poem, where the eagle of justice points to his eyebrow and says, "You see this fifth star over here? This is not really an eyebrow. These are five saved souls of just people. The fifth is the Trojan Rhipaeus, who is mentioned nowhere else in classical literature except in the Aeneid. And somehow or other, the eagle says, by the mystery of God's justice, which is beyond any human comprehension, he is here, and we ask ourselves, why?" Very simply, Virgil's poetry saved him. And if Virgil's poetry could save him, it must have saved Virgil as well. And that's extraordinary, I think. Dante insists that there can be no dividing line, historical or theological, between the two cultures, that somehow or other, they must continue to complement one another. So I'm glad you asked that question.
No, thank you. I think that speaks to a robust Christian humanism that's looking for relations in broader culture and encouraging for us too, as we are reading the literature of our own day. The last question we have, it's actually teeing you up to where we began. Guy Despino writes, "Excellent summary and presentation. Is there any possibility of an online course or seminar subscription on Dante? And maybe you can just give a pitch again for your program on edX, and then I'll hand it over to Michael after that.
Great. So very, very briefly, the possibility is quite real and immediate. With great gratitude to Georgetown University, which made the project possible. The My Dante project at Georgetown has produced a three-part online course through the edX network, EDX. It's a consortium with Harvard and MIT at the head. Georgetown is part of it, that has produced free online college-level courses. And you can go to dante.georgetown.edu if you'd like to look at some of those materials. It's meant to be not for scholars, but for those who want assistance in reading the Divine Comedy individually or in a small discussion group, but carefully, contemplatively, and personally.
Thank you very much, Frank Ambrosio, for an excellent paper and discussion. This is Joe Simmons in the United States, handing it back over to Mike Scott across the pond in England.
Mike, hi, thank you very much. Thank you both. What a stimulating session that was, Frank. And I know why your students speak so highly of you, as do your colleagues. It was a wonderful talk this afternoon. Thank you very much for it. Thanks also to you, Joe, for making this such an enjoyable event. The next talk in our series will be on the 4th of May, when another very distinguished speaker in Dr. Graham Ward, who is the Regius Professor of Divinity at Oxford University. And he'll be speaking about Sighs and Eden in the poetry of Vaughan, Traherne, and Wordsworth. And looking forward to that very much indeed. On Thursday, the 29th of April, that's this Thursday at 11 a.m. EST, 4 p.m. BST, we have an event teaming up with the Free Speech Project at Georgetown, when we will be addressing the question, can free speech and human rights survive the pandemic? And this is an international discussion with distinguished speakers from the USA, UK, France, and quite amazingly, really, from Bangladesh, that we'll be able to get a link up there as well. It's something not to be missed. We had a practice session a little earlier today, and a terrific discussion started straight away. So again, my thanks to Frank today, also to Joe, not just for introducing this, but also for being the co-convener of the series. And Joe is at Campion Hall, Oxford. That's a picture of it behind him, even though he's in the USA. Thanks to all of you who have submitted questions. I'd also like to thank those at Georgetown University who make this happen, especially our administrator, Yvonne Kreck, who's quite marvelous in getting us all together and getting these Zoom presentations possible. Special thanks to Professor Catherine Temple at Georgetown for feeding the questions to Joe. At Campion Hall, thanks to Nick Austin, SJ, who's the master of the hall, to Sarah Gray and Ying Ying, our Campion Hall administrators. At Blackfriars, my thanks as ever to Dr. Richard Finn, OP, director of the Las Casas Institute, and Dr. John O'Connor, OP, the regent. At Georgetown, I'd like to thank as ever Dr. Jack DeGioia, the president, and Dr. Tom Banchoff, vice president, global affairs, who supports these series and really put a lot of energy into it as well. Finally, my thanks to all of you for being part of the audience. Please join us again on the 29th of April, that's this Thursday, for that international event, and also on the 4th of May for Dr. Graham Ward. In the meantime, take care, keep safe. I'm Mike Scott. Please follow me on Twitter at Mike Scott Prof. Thank you and goodbye.